Welcome everyone to another episode of AppSec 101. I am pleased to be joined today by Chris Dion. And Chris is a new member of our team here on Team Fortify. And while he's a new member of our team, he is not a newbie to the industry. He's actually been working in software for over 5 years now as a developer, and then later as a solution architect. And Chris has also worked with multiple companies of various industries, and he's seen the standards for QA testing change to address today's customer demands. And that really is going to be our topic for discussion today. Chris, we're going to be talking about, you know, application security, why it isn't secondary, but it really should be primary. And so, Chris, welcome aboard. Glad to have you on today for our discussion.
Awesome. Thank you for having me, Andrew. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. Well, let's get things started off just by talking about AppSec programs in general. Mm-hmm. So first of all, you know, why do organizations need an AppSec program?
So the main reason why we are seeing a lot of AppSecs becoming more on the topic for quality assurance is because we start seeing a lot of exploitations in the press. So we start seeing things where malicious users are actually starting to kind of being showcased in the front of a lot of financial news, a lot of ransomwares, a lot of situations where, you know, malicious users have essentially breached a company's data privacy and have essentially led to a lot of exploitation of sorts. So companies are now coming with the new standards of sorts where security needs to be on the same level as a functionally and well-performed tool that they're going to be selling to their end users.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, no one wants their business to end up in the headlines as the latest data breach.
Absolutely. And
yeah, I saw an interesting stat just recently from IBM Research. I can post the link in the description. But it said that the average data breach cost is now over $4 million.
Mm-hmm.
So like I said, no one wants their company to end up in the headlines as the latest data breach. You know, and AppSec programs are a big part of preventing that. So in your experience, what does a robust AppSec program look like?
Sure. So, you know, in the typical, in today's environment, you start seeing AppSecs involved in the DevOps environment, specifically towards web applications, because, you know, deliverables have to be on a very timely fashion, if not, you know, have the flexibility of just releasing hot fixes if needed. So in that environment, we start having this DevOps practice and mindset where testing should occur in the same fashion as functional testing. So in that case, we start shifting left towards the developer, which is the trend that we start seeing in today's industries. And we see them do continual small and large scale testing efforts done from the developers and shifting all the way over to quality assurance so that they have more time, because really time is of the essence, and anything that would, add more time or just be more impactful usage of time in regards to automating security testing, much in the same way as you see people automating functional testing, is a must need and to be competitive, especially when you have other solutions going about and doing the same thing. So if you're not essentially being cutting edge with DevOps practices, you're allowing your competitors to kind of take the lead and gain charge of that.
Yeah, and you know, I'm glad you brought up quality, because quality is so critical in building applications. And you and I have talked about quality gates.
Sure.
And for those that maybe haven't heard that term before, what is a quality gate?
Sure. So a quality gate is, in short, kind of a way to say, before we release this product, before it goes into the next phase, there needs to be a gate / standard that we need to achieve. So if we were to go with a functional application or functional testing perspective, we are looking for an application that is achieving X, Y, and Z functionalities. From a security perspective, we're really looking for something that has a percentage of risk that is, achievable for us, something that we are satisfied with. A lot of people say is like, well, there must be 0% risk from a security perspective. And that's really great if you can achieve that. But realistically speaking, you're not going to have the time to address all of them. That's why the quality gate essentially establishes the threshold of risk before you actually pushes it to either the next phase in development or towards the production environment itself.
Okay, yeah, no, that definitely makes sense. So maybe you could give us a couple examples. What do some traditional quality gates look like?
Sure. So from if we go again with the DevOps practices, a lot of the times we start seeing quality gates established in the pipeline perspective. So if we were to go from a CI/CD pipeline, we'll say Azure for an example, and we were wanting to essentially establish a quality gate, we will say when this test results return, the security scan in this case, returns, we need to have a threshold of X amount of issues or a percentage of that issues. And this can all be established within the pipeline configuration. But once you have that quality gate established, you will essentially prevent any deployment of your application to that next phase. So if your pipeline says, okay, at this time, which is the end of the life cycle or end of this sprint of sorts, we will need to push this application to the next phase. But again, the quality gate will stop it from going into that deployment phase and will go into more of a, you know, an error of sorts, which is essentially just a way of saying like, there is an issue here, this is a problem, does not meet threshold or does not meet the expectation of this quality gate, and it will stop the deployment phase. So it will let you know if something is not up to snuff, again, to your standards that you establish.
Okay. Well, Chris, from what I know about application development, it seems like now the frequency of releases is more than ever. Mm-hmm. And just, you know, the for security to keep up with the frequency of releases is sometimes difficult. What would you say to those people that are maybe putting too much of an emphasis on the development side of things and maybe not enough emphasis on security and actually testing to make sure that they're meeting these standards of quality?
Right. So a lot of people, like you pointed out earlier in the interview about the financial cost of, you know, a vulnerability being discovered, there are other things that goes with it as well. Much with the transitional, you know, mentality with performance solutions. So back in like the early 90s and or the late 90s and 2000s, you start realizing, all right, I have a really great functional solution. But then you start realizing that you don't have the, you know, the bandwidth to actually support the user base that you wanted to. Hence why support of having a performance solution was in fact, you know, a main staple in today's industry. But then very back into the early days, they were people very much in the same kind of mindset where it's like, well, if I have a great product, it doesn't matter. People will love my product regardless of the performance because the capabilities will be the ones that I'm selling, not the performance. And in today's society, we see the same mindset except with security. Great, I have a very functional and well-performing solution that is allowing my customers to have all this functionality. But really, if the privacy of my data, or if some malicious user can actually exploit the actual application, we start seeing not only a financial loss and either lawsuits or anything like that, but we actually start seeing a diminish in, you know, branding as well. So we start seeing companies that if like say Amazon is a huge company, but they had problems with data privacy at one point. And with that came a situation where they took a hit. They allowed their competitors to have more say in the market space because they have a more secure application. And that is something that in today's customers' demands is becoming more and more a necessity. Not having, you know, just some ex-hacker just coming in and getting any information they want from you. And that can vary from your name to very sensitive information about you as a person. And it's just, it's all about having good recognition of not only the financial costs, but the branding of your application, how you stand with your competitors, and just again meeting up with those customer demands.
Yeah, absolutely. And you used the word necessity, and that word stood out to me. I think that is very true. I think it is a necessity to have these security quality gates in place, because if you want your application to be competitive long term, then investing in security is a necessity.
Absolutely.
So maybe let's talk about some other benefits, you know, but besides the benefit of your application being secure, maybe what are some other benefits of having a solid AppSec program in place?
Sure. So going from a developer's perspective, you can start looking at security as a way to enable better code practices. So back in my developer's days, there's usually a list of things that are like, this is how we work, this is how we write code, follow these practices to, you know, make it more cohesive and more interchangeable between hands. But really, when it comes to implementing security security practices inside those code mentalities, you actually are allowing your developers to grow inside their own respected fields. They are developing better products, more stable products, because they are not allowing these vulnerabilities to, you know, go around. And I can go on with like data, with like memory leaks, or, you know, kind of like SQL injections as a simple example to kind of showcase that. But really, a lot of things that come with it is, you know, you're allowing your own development team, the people who are creating this product for you guys to sell, and you're allowing them to be better at it, not just simply say, I need the work done as fast as possible, and I need you to just check the boxes. And there's ways to incorporate this again. Like automation is a great way to address the fact that this is a new demand put onto the development team, and we are able to then address it in a very offhand way. So really, their job has not changed. Their day-to-day should not change. They're just having to address more precise defects when it comes to their, you know, shift left early testing phase.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I saw some messaging a while back from a data security company that said something like, hackers don't care if you've checked the boxes.
Right.
You know, it's something, you know, along that of this mindset of this checkbox security or checkbox compliance, where if you have that mindset, you will inherently be leaving some gaps. And you know, you need to be thinking of security as, like you mentioned, it needs to be primary. It can't be this secondary. It can't be taking a backseat to the speed and the frequency of development.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, this mindset with security being secondary, it's the same mindset that we saw with performance testing. It's just going to be a matter of time before it's just going to be considered the new standard. Because again, a new standard is only made when competition takes advantage of it, and people are taking advantage of it right now.
Right. Well, let's talk about some solutions that are out there for people. Sure. We may have some viewers that are just getting started on their AppSec journeys. And what are some tips or some best practices that you could give to them?
Right. So there are some practices that you can instill without a solution. So if you wanted to look into some compliance standards, OWASP does a lot of those situations. So if you want to take more of a on-hands approach, not really relying on a solution, you can do that from that perspective. In regards to solutions, there are plenty on the markets. Obviously, you know, an enterprise level solution is the Fortify set of solutions, which again is it comes in a lot of versatility, as well as the expanded supported libraries addressing it. So if you are ever in the market for an application or multiple applications that ranges in different languages, frame structures, frameworks, as well as just in general a verbose technology stack that your company deals with, really having a technology or a solution, a security solution to address all that is pretty important.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. Well, Chris, I want to say thanks to you for taking some time out of your day to talk to us about application security programs. And do you have any final thoughts, any final words or tips you'd like to leave with us?
None so much as just a, you know, just a kind of reminder that, you know, the application that you guys are spending so much time on, it really is all about not making a misstep on the first delivery. So long as you're aware of that and you take every step to make sure it's a, you know, every step is the right step, having the application on the marketplace should be the easiest part.
Yeah, well said. Well, thanks again, Chris. And, you know, to our viewers that are watching this episode, if you enjoyed this content, please feel free to subscribe to Fortify Unplugged. Leave a comment down below and hit that like button to see more great AppSec 101 videos. Thanks, everyone. And we'll see you next time.